Wasn't scared.
Good morning. Yeah.
How's it going?
Great.
Great.
For those of you who weren't in Vino last year, I want to introduce our next speaker. This is a gentleman that was introduced to me by some of my friends in Reno. We met at Macaroni Grill one night over a couple of vodkas, and to give you an idea of this man's intelligence, he had just been to Borders Bookstore, and he had a book on Arabic, the Arabic language, I think it was, or famous Arabic quotes, and it was all written in Arabic, and he said, have you ever seen this before? And he's going over the things and he's interpreting the Arabic for me. And I said, of course I know that language, but it's like the back of my hand, and I wouldn't get him, you know. This man speaks six languages, I think, isn't it, David?
What's the graphical, yeah.
Graphically. I think more than most of us can do, anyway. This is Dr. David Russell. He has a PhD in natural medicine. He has other degrees in medicine. Ayurvedic is one, correct? Vedic medicine. He has a degree in homeopathy from Europe, correct?
Yes.
Most of your practice is what? Chronic degenerative disease,
yes.
Perhaps?
Yes, correct.
From a psycho-emotional standpoint,
yes.
Pretty much?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll let you start with that then. All right. Dr. David Russell.
Good morning, and again, I thank Chris for the introduction, and really look forward to being together with you here again. And I'd just like to say a few things in preparation for the presentation this morning. I'm going to be presenting some aspects of medicine in a holistic context that was very much like my esteemed colleague yesterday, the woman doing the Ayurvedic presentation. And there are two goals that I'd like to achieve with you today. And one of them is to understand the biological context, perhaps from a different point of view than your training and your experience has allowed so far. To do that, I would beg your indulgence in what I'm going to do. There are going to be some foreign terms. We're going to be using some models, biological models that might be new to some of you. And don't let this over-challenge you in any way. Just sort of relax and look at this as a journey in concepts, a journey in seeing something unfold. We're going to be looking at the biological event, the biological terrain in a new way. And this is not just another tradition, because I'm going to be combining the five major classical traditions of medicine, Chinese, Tibetan, Ayurvedic, Islamic, Semitic, and the old European tradition in classical medicine. I'm going to be combining those and sort of putting them together. But I'm going to use as a point of reference, because most of you are familiar with one or more of these terms, I'm going to be using the Ayurvedic model and the Chinese medical model. And I'm sort of going to put them together, because some of you are familiar with one kind of terminology, some of the other. And so I'm going to kind of put them together so you can see how they fit. How they actually correspond to one another, so you become a little familiar with some of these terms. Now, we have to remember one thing before we start. One of the great advantages and great strengths of allopathic Western medicine is also its greatest downfall, its greatest tragedy, and its greatest weakness, and that is its obsession with matter. Its obsession with matter. We have this kind of dichotomy. We hear in groups like this, in so-called holistic or biological groups, all over, you keep hearing these different things that sound opposite. You have people talking about energies doing all kinds of things. Then you have people talking about matter, you know, the biochemistry and the macrobiology and the microbiology of things happening in living organisms. And it seems like we have to be on one side or the other. But in reality, we have to understand this all truly in one integrated whole. And I would be so bold, and please indulge me in this, I would say that any of you, anyone working And taking the responsibility for working with a living organism, be this person a farmer or a dentist or a doctor, if you're missing this part of the equation, then you shouldn't be working with living organisms, because you're missing the very foundation of life and what really happens and what really is going on. All of the materialistic Cartesian theories in the world, in spite of their wonderful advances and the contributions they've made to eliminating suffering and helping humanity, will not make up for losing this part of it. So please do not underestimate the importance of these models. Now, you don't have to understand them in the same sense I do. There's no test after this, as there is in medical school for this other kind of knowledge. But please look at this presentation as a poem or as a work of art, as a painting. Let your conceptual mind work with this, because we need to see things not just in terms of matter, but in terms of concepts, and see how they move and how they weave and how they really live. This is very beautiful, and if I can bring this sense of beauty to you today and nothing else, then I will have really achieved what I wanted to, because it is truly like that. The classical medical sciences have been around for centuries and centuries. If you want peer papers to prove all this, well, you can have them. In every one of these sciences, for about the last 1,000 years, there have been continual peer papers written. And when you want to really get into that, and you have get yourself a U-Haul and get the books and spend the next 10 years studying this and reading these peer papers, you will find that this is a very exact science. This has nothing to do with woo-woo stuff, but we're talking about very consistent scientific nature of looking at things. But we're looking at them in terms of functions and concepts rather than in terms of things. Now, the first thing I'd like to present in that sense is this continuum of matter and energy. You know, we're all obsessed with this, I say, in matter and energy. And the first one to really get into this in the modern world, in the scientific world, was Einstein. And we know about his theory of relativity, matter and energy, and how they coalesce. I want to show you what this looks like in classical medicine, because, of course, they've been doing this. I mean, Einstein could have saved himself an awful lot of trouble by just going to the library and reading some of these old texts, because there it was, but he just never really understood it. And I'm going to present that to you, the matter-energy configuration as presented in classical science, for one thing. But I do want you to understand that this is the bottom line of all biological events. And here we have, in the Western world, the intricacies, the intersection of science and medicine in our world. We have to turn for the closest Western models to these classical medical models that we have to turn to in our science are quantum physics and fractal geometry. If you really understand the basic concepts of fractal geometry and quantum physics and quantum mechanics, you will understand all of the scientific metaphors of classical medicine. So I'm going to present those together for you. And I just wanted to point that out so none of you feel left out and say, well, how can we really believe this stuff? But I want to show this to you. And what we'll be doing, and I chose for this presentation because it's a dental conference, I'll be presenting this all about dentistry. The classical medical concepts of how we can understand the events of the oral cavity relating to the biological functions of the whole human being. So, without further ado, that was a lot of ado. Now, you have to, let me hear, this is the first time I'm doing this really high-tech stuff here. All right. So, yesterday, I decided that I'd have to make a little model like this, and that's why it's kind of funny looking. But here is this traditional symbol, the Taoistic symbol of the yin and the yang that you've all seen, all familiar with, in terms of classical Chinese medicine. Now, what I want to show you is this, so that we can go on with the rest of the lecture here. This symbol has actually four parts. It has the circle around it. And remember, this is like a mental computer. This is not just some little symbol like a tattoo that some Chinese guy figured out that this was really cool to make it look like that. This is actually an energetic computer. And it tells you, when you know how to look at this, it tells you exactly how things function. And you can put anything into this computer and you'll be getting the same results. I put this information, and I'll describe that to you, but it's a model of how things work on a quantum level. You have four parts. You have the circle here. This is what in English you call the void. I'm using the Chinese terms here so that we don't get too off base. Chong and Kong. And I will be referring to those later when we go into the meridians. And I say, don't be intimidated by the language, but we have to use some term to denote these things. Chong is the state of non-resistance, or emptiness, or the void, or the place in which all events take place and exist, irregardless of what they are, but where everything in that void is in total balance. Total balance. And I will refer to that as we go on to the other parts of the oral cavity. Kong is the more of the term that quantum physics would use for the universal field energies. It is truly a void, passive, in which all other events take place. It has the principle of non-resistance. If any of you are familiar with Ayurveda, it's called Akasha in Sanskrit. And it means the place of non-resistance in which everything takes place. In the Christian or the Semitic religions, that void is called in Hebrew tohu and bohu, which means the void. You remember from Genesis, the abyss, the emptiness in creation in Genesis 1. This is what they're talking about there. Now, then you have our good friends, matter and energy, as we're always talking about in our thing. Now, what is the relationship between matter and energy? Well, nobody seems to know, because we're all talking about different things from the standpoint of matter, rather than how these things are synergistically together. Now, in Chinese, matter is referred to as a yin event. It contains the anabolic processes of all biological functions. In both Chinese and Ayurvedic, it is related to the earth and the water element, as our colleague told us last night. And it's related to the kapha dosha that she was speaking about. So I won't go into those things, but just to refer to them so you'll know where they fit into this Einsteinian model of matter and energy and how they transform. On the other side, you have the yang energies, which represent energy concept. They are catabolic in nature, biological functions. They represent vata in Sanskrit, in Ayurveda. And they make up the elements of space or ether in Ayurveda. And it's called the element of wood in Chinese medicine. And in Ayurveda, it's also the vayu or air element, which is called metal in Chinese. Now, you'll notice one interesting thing. Here's one side, the yang, yin, all these aspects here. But then we have this other component here going through. Very important to understand this part here. This is the element of fire. It's also called pitta in Sanskrit, or agni in Sanskrit. I won't go into the Chinese for this because it's not really necessary. But it represents metabolic processes. In Greek, the word metabolism really is metabolism. And it truly means... I have to change gears here in language here for a moment. Transformation of matter. Excuse me, am I a short circuit there once in a while in my languages here? The transformation of matter. Now, transformation of matter on the chemical level that we've been talking about this weekend is the most superficial of all forms of metabolism. You know, that we can take in chemistry, all learned in chemistry, you take this chemical and pour it in there, and it does that because this molecule goes there and that electron goes there. And that's a kind of transformation of matter, but it's not the true metabolism. When we're talking about metabolism on this level, we're talking about this very total transformation of matter to energy and energy to matter. When we're talking about metabolism biochemically in the general intestinal tract and in the tissues, what in Sanskrit you call Dhatu Agni, the Agni, the fire of transformation and metabolism in the tissues and the cells, we're talking about complete transformations. We're talking about the fact that if you eat a carrot, we were talking about carrots yesterday, and the carrots have phosphor in it, because we can take that carrot apart and look and say, oh, it's got phosphor in it. When you put that carrot into your mouth and it meets the Agni, the holy sacred fire of metabolism, of transformation of matter, the entire molecule of phosphorus becomes destroyed, burned up. It does not just fit together chemically with another chemical in the body and produce nutrition. No, it does not. It is completely transformed into something else. And what does it become transformed into? This person, not that person or that person, but this person, which is more than just a biochemical entity. There are individuation processes which are sacred to identity, which are involved in this metabolic process. This is such a sacred process that this word Agni was originally a god in Sanskrit, in the Hindu pantheon. And when the Christian missionaries were trying to translate the Bible from English into Hindi, they used the word Agni for the Holy Spirit. That's where that concept comes from. The life bringer, the sustainer of life, the comforter of life, and the transformer of things and events into identity and life itself. And that's what's going on here. Now, this pitta and the agni is in the humble part of our body, which is the general intestinal tract. And I want to show you how all this fits together. I'll be getting to the point soon. For the dental congress here, about how these things work and why the dental part is so essential. Now, believe me, esteemed colleagues in dentistry, you hold in your profession and in what you do or don't do to people one of the most important foundations of health that there is. And we are talking, when we're talking about the oral cavity, we're talking about the very center of the mammalian biological organism in its most holistic aspects. And that's what I want to show you this morning about that. And I hope that impresses you, not what I'm saying to you, but these concepts. Because, well, to use a... what they call the, somebody mentioned that yesterday, I think it was Dr. Klingart, the Arana axioms here. You know what's funny about teeth? Look at them anatomically, very simply, forget everything you learned in dental school. The tooth is the only organ of the body that is in our body in such an unstable way. Just a few little periodontal ligaments, right? Why? Because it's made to fall out. It's the only part of the body that ejects itself when something's wrong with it and needs to. The only part that does that. Now, nature built that in there for a very important purpose, because what you do or don't do to the teeth and the oral cavity is going to have a profound effect on the entire body-mind matrix of the biological organism itself. So you better be darn careful that everything you do there is on target. Otherwise, you are compromising the health of this person, like even the MDs who are wonderful at compromising the health of living organisms, vaccines, prescription drugs, knives, whatever all, you know, what makes all of us classical doctors shiver and take rescue remedy, but dentists, with their rather benign things, you know, and this and that, can do far more damage on this deeper level. So we need to understand how that fits into the biological point. Now, you all familiar to some degree with acupuncture, Chinese. We are not going to get in a lot of detail about this, but these meridians, channels, nadis, they're called in Sanskrit, of biological functional energy, of which there are many kinds, many types, going up through these meridians, very precise places with very precise points, controlling very precise biological, psychological processes. Okay, now I'm going to concentrate this morning on the part of this that has to do with the oral cavity and the rest of the body. And I want this to really impress you, because I want you to see how this stuff all sets up. Many of the things Dr. Klinghart was speaking about, and I believe Dr. Gary, and a lot of the things we've heard here, this is, I hope this starts making sense to you when you're looking at this, because there's a method behind the madness. These things really do fit together. Just to show you here, this is a this is the Rain Mai meridian, or the Rain Mo, depending on what dialect of Chinese you're speaking. And just to show you how important this is the main yin meridian of the entire body. Remember yin we were talking about? It's the matter part. It's the anabolic part of our metabolism. It's the earth and water part. It's basically the way that we become a form that all cells are developed from, all the tendencies of energy to transform into matter. That's this meridian here. See where it starts in the oral cavity. Travels down through the entire viscera of the body into the genital and reproductive organ area. And all you'll see that in my abstract in the back of your little blue folders here about the human organism in the oral cavity, whatever I gave that title, or I can't remember. But I did recall that I did write in there that in all classical medicine, and I don't care if we're talking about Islamic or Tibetan or Chinese or whatever, there's a mirror between complementary. Polar complementaries. You've got one polar end in the oral cavity, the other polar end is in the pelvic organs. Just remember that always. Oral cavity to pelvic organs. And everything in between are intersecting energy continuum. So I just wanted to show you how important that was, that this is how classical medicine looks at this stuff. Now we're going to go into something a little more complex here, but I want to show you, well, not complex, but is this upside? No, it's right side up. Very good. Just look at how this is. These are the biological circuits, the main biological circuits of the yin-yang. This is the Einstein's theory of relativity shown in a biological matrix. This is the yin and the yang transforming in the human organism, the transformation of matter and energy back and forth, like that, like the one I started with the Taoist symbol on it. This is how it looks in the body. This is how it looks in the body. Now, notice one thing. Here we have the yin-yang at its maximum. Where is that? The pelvic area. This is where the yin-yang energies, matter and energy, and their transformation is at its strongest point. The strongest point of the human organism is there. Now, you'll notice the yin energy is coming down, transferring here, going up as yang energies, and look at this. The yin-yang balance, the balance of all living metabolic processes, spiritual, mental, emotional, and physical, are in what the Chinese call the shir el in Chinese, and I'll be coming to that in just a moment. The oral cavity and its functions up here in the tongue and this whole area here is where the entire balance of all matter and energy events take place in the human organism. That's how important this is. All right. Now, let's take a look at one of my favorite meridians here. Unfortunately, I've done this so often for myself. It's the first time I've made these little slinky things here. But please disregard all my atrocious notes here. But I love this meridian. and so I can't keep from doing funny things with it. Now, this is the Chong Mai, or the Chong Mo meridian. Recall what I said before? The Chong in Chinese means this non-resisting void where all these events take place. Now, that's not just a poetic gesture on the part of the Chinese. What this means is it's a cavity. It's a crucible, which they would call it in alchemy. It's a chamber. It's a place in which these events occur. It's like, let's think of it as a crucible. All of the elements of all different kinds, the matter, the energy, everything that exists is put into this, and it mixes and goes on, and out of this comes the events itself. Out of this comes matter and energy itself. And that's why this meridian, the most important one, is called the Chong Mai, because this is the source of life in the human being. This is an extra meridian. Maybe many of you who know something about Chinese medicine or acupuncture aren't even familiar with this meridian. That's because the Chinese keep all this stuff secret. They really like that. They know that all of us guys with round eyes, we're never going to get this. So they don't even bother telling us. But this is kind of secret information. Therefore, look at this meridian. Here is the great part of the maximum yin-yang metabolism going on here. But where does it start? In the Chong Mai, just like in the Rain Mai, right up in the oral cavity. And it goes down like this into the viscera, into the entire function of the reproductive organ, pelvic organs, and ends up here. Now I want to tell you in detail about some of these things, because it's not just enough to know where this stuff runs in the body. I want you to understand a little bit of what's going on in this meridian. Up here, we have this area called the Shir El. Now, the Shir El, El in Chinese means two. And when you're using the number two, you're talking about all of the configurations of energy and matter in the entire universe. In other words, yin and yang. Where is that in the body? Right up there. That's why they call it the Shir El. Now, it's the oral cavity. But up in the back of the oral cavity here where this runs, this is a meeting, of the pancreas and the heart. This is where the yin and the yang energies, when it was going up through the body that we were speaking about before on the yin and yang sides, where they transfer. There's a little place up in the back of the palate, one point, where all of this changes, like a switch, and the yang energy becomes yin, anabolic, and starts to flow down through the body and through the viscera. The place it flows to, first of all, is the heart. The heart is the center of man. It's also called in Chinese the Shaoyin. Now, Shaoyin is the deepest of all meridians in the entire body. It holds what the Chinese call the heart fire and the kidney yin. And here we have the concept of the cauldron of metabolism. You have the energy, the heart fire. The heart is the center of the whole organism, spiritually, biologically, emotionally. Everything that metabolizes, that transforms, makes us into what we are and keeps our life going, keeps producing new cells, is this fire. It's coming especially from the heart in this, and I'll show you more about that later. Now, what does this do? This has to produce something. If we were just energies, we wouldn't even be here. We would just be energies. Energy must transform into matter. And this matter of transformation is the kidney yin. And it's contained in this whole extra, whole other meridian that I won't go into, called the Shaoyin in Chinese. And that's controlled by this point here, up in the oral cavity. That's how important that is. Now, that connects to this yin meridian that I showed you just before, that Rain Mai, you know, that was where the frontal, where it was going down from the oral cavity. It connects, this point here connects directly to that. As a matter of fact, that CV really means Rain Mai in Chinese. That's one of the high points, acupuncture points of the Rain Mai meridian. Now, the Rain Mai meridian, among other things, it's a kidney meridian, has its origins in the kidney. It's a yin meridian. It's the main yin meridian of the body. And it corresponds to DNA in our Western medical kind of terminology. It's called Yuan Qi, and Yuan Qi is the greatest form of hereditary, genetic, and active energies which go into metabolism. The Guanqi is what determines our constitution, determines our lifespan, determines all of the basic fundamental aspects of energetic events, anabolic and catabolic, in the body. All of the primary digestive metabolism is controlled from those places, right up there. Now, isn't that interesting? You remember from your old anatomy, excuse me, just one more, you remember from your own old anatomy courses that you know that the gut starts right here, doesn't it? And ends way down here in one long tube, right? Well, embryologically, yes, it does. And it still does in an anatomical sense. And that is why the postnatal nutrition of events of metabolism in the body and the mind, they start there. They're not there. These are just different types of qualifying organs. The stomach, the small intestine, the liver. Yes, very, very important. But the main events, the main energetic events in the concept of life and nutrition and metabolism are not only start right here, but are controlled from there. That's where your digestion is controlled. That's where the stomach functions are controlled. That's where the hydrochloric acid and the this and the that and the under the enzymes, all controlled from up there. And that's why supplementation is just a band-aid. Because if you don't get this right, you're not going to get the enzymes right. You're not going to get the vitamin metabolism. You're not going to get it. You're just going to be supplementing and supplementing and supplementing, and sure, it's going to have an effect. Yes, it's going to have a symptomatic effect. You're not healing anything because you haven't healed the fundamental way in which the body itself functions. And that's the point of this. Now, starts up here. It goes down to this part here with all these parts. These are kidney meridian things here, from 12 to 20 acupuncture points, the entire general intestinal tract. It's also what the Chinese call, I love these words, they're very poetic, the palace of bone marrow. Palaces in Chinese are very, very important. They mean things. Palaces are where the king and his advisors live. And then Confucian concept of Chinese medicine, this is where things are controlled from. So the administrators of all these digestive processes coming down here, they live in these palaces down here, and that's why they call them. But the palace of bone marrow, this is the connection not only to the general intestinal tract, but to the central nervous system functions. Central nervous system functions. Right down in this area here. This is also called the confluences of all vital energies. Now, in Sanskrit, that's called bala, B-A-L-A, bala. Everything that we would call prana, chi, biological energy, vital energy, etheric energy, whatever you want to call it, that's what they mean there. This is the confluence of that. This is where those energies are put into these cauldrons or these spaces in which they become resolved and transformed in the digestive fire of this area of the body, of the general intestinal tract. That's what's happening there. It's also, we also see in this area here, in the genital area, urogenital area, is what they call the lower heater, lower triple warmer in Chinese, for those of you familiar with acupuncture. This is the area that our esteemed colleague in Ayurveda yesterday was talking about when she was speaking about the place of vata. This is the colon area that controls all of the energetic functions of the pelvic organs. This is the origin of vata. And it also controls the function of the central nervous system, the vata. And that's why, because in this area, we're getting this confluence of energies working in that area.
David?
Yes.
Excuse me, yeah. You said
bala? Bala, yes. Yes.
It's the same root word.
Well, it is. And interestingly enough, for those of you who are interested in Hebrew and Sanskrit, there are some areas in Persia, in the old Persian, in which we see an incultural influx which reflected into the early Semitic of Hebrew and also the Indo-European languages, which is really quite, which of course Sanskrit is a major Indo-European language. It's kind of interesting. That we'll have to wait for another lecture for that. A biological language or something, we can do that. But thank you for pointing that out. And this area here on the upper warmer, which is the seat of Kapha that she was talking about yesterday, is the master heart area. And it controls all of what they call, in Chinese, the shens. Now, the shens, shen in Chinese means spirit. And this is kind of metaphoric. In other words, there's a particular type of energy. There's a particular type of quote-unquote spirit, not to be taken literally, of the metabolic yin organs that are controlling these things. The heart center up in the Kapha area here is what controls that. So the main tuning or the main programming of all of these yin anabolic transformation organ systems is controlled right up in here through this meridian in what the seat in Ayurveda is what they call Kapha there. Controls all the shens. Very, very important. Chinese doctors, when they're doing dental work and looking at you, and they're doing pulses and they're trying to figure out how your shen's working, because it doesn't help to go in and start yanking out teeth or putting in fillings or taking them out or doing anything else until you know that the master steering programs, the shens of these organ systems, are up and running. Because if they're not, don't do anything like that until they are. Because if you do, you're going to compromise this person's health. And it doesn't matter how many bacteria they're full of, and it doesn't matter how much bone loss is going on at the time. You've got to get this fundamental biological life of this organism more or less stable before you go in and start doing these kind of things to it, you see? We have to learn how to be sensitive to this. All right. This point here, stomach 30, is called Qi Chong in Chinese. And here we hit that void again. Now, interestingly enough, this is a wonderful thing. It means the void of Qi, or the emptiness of Qi, or the place which all Qi configurates, where all the Qi is put into this big empty pot and becomes all these things. That's what that stomach 30 point really means. That stomach 30 point right there goes directly into all the pelvic organs and especially the reproductive organs. Very important. It controls the function of the reproductive organs. And out of this, and I'm just using those terms for those of you who's familiar with it, the rest of it, just forget it because it's not important. Ojas, which is the Sanskrit term in Ayurveda for all basic immunity of the entire body. Bala, which is the basis of all vital energies and functions of the entire body. In Chinese, you call the ojas the wei qi, for those of you familiar with that, wei qi. It's called defensive qi in Confucian acupuncture, and it's basic immunity, again. Now, they also call that stomach 30 point, interestingly enough, they call it the reunion of food and the sea of nourishment. Isn't that beautiful? Ah, the sea of nourishment and the reunion of food. Now, how in the world could that be down there when all the digestion physiologically is up in here? That's what we learned. But no, not true. Remember what our colleague was saying yesterday about the days it takes to digest things? This is because metabolism goes through tissues, not through the general intestinal tract, in its true chemical and nutritive form. So it goes through all these tissues, fat tissues, muscle tissues, bone tissues, nerve tissues, and it ends up, oh, there you are, dear. And it ends up here in the reproductive organs. The reproductive organs are the last organs of digestion that we have in the body. It's called the Sukra Dhatu. And it takes the vital energies of food that started out up here and go down through this system, but through all the tissues, taking these 30 to 40 days to metabolize from when we first put it into our mouth. And the most refined essence, which is the ojas and the bala, this most refined essence of energy and matter, which is what the old alchemists called the philosopher's stone, is transferred energetically and tissue-wise into the reproductive organs. There it is further refined, and it goes directly up through this system into the heart. Into the heart. And from the heart is dispersed throughout all the cellular metabolism of the entire organism. Now, why the reproductive system is so important in understanding these things, which the Ayurvedic and the Chinese and everybody else understands except us. Now, why? Because, you see, the reproductive organs do not just reproduce phylogenetic offspring. We know they do that. You know, you can have a baby. We know this little thing, these little zygotes and the sperm and the eggs and everything get together and they make a human, and it comes out and, you know, we're reproducing something. That's why they call it the reproductive system. But all of us know that there are millions of cells dying in our own bodies every moment. Where is those getting reproduced? Boy, millions of cells, that would probably, if I didn't have anything to reproduce those in my body, I would probably not be here by the time I got to Tucson, going home this afternoon. I'd be all gone. So what reproduces this? Our reproductive system. The reproductive system reproduces life in the organism. It also, as a side event, reproduces phylogenetic offspring. But its greatest job is to reproduce my life, my identity, not just my biological life, my identity in its mind, spiritual, mental, emotional, and physical. It reproduces me all the time. I'm in a constant state of reproduction. And when I eat food, we all know, well, I've got to eat food or you'll die. Yeah, because the food nourishes you. Nourishment equals reproduction. We can stay alive. That has to go through our reproductive organs and systems before it can nourish us, because that's the only part of us that really does nourish us. And that's where these meridians come in and why they are so very important. And the Chinese, I just love that little diadem there, that stomach 30, it's right on the Mons Pubis here, and it goes right into the genitals, that point, the reunion of food and the sea of nourishment. Now, when the Chinese use these poetic words, when they say sea, there, it's a visual metaphor. This, the ocean, is what contains all the water power of the earth and the world between the heaven and the earth. We even have it in Genesis about the Spirit of God hovering over the waters. These are the seas to the Chinese. Wow, so we're talking here about the sea of nourishment. This is the great ocean of the nourishment, the biological nourishment for the whole organism. Stomach 30, qi chong, the void, the cauldron, the crucible of all the qis that are ending up from the nourishment that you're taking in. It starts in the oral cavity and goes down here. Whatever's happening up here that you're doing or not doing to these teeth and the bite and the gums and the tongues and everything else is going to directly affect what goes on here. So better be careful. Better be careful. Now, this goes down from here and it comes out here. This point here is also, last point I'd like to talk about in this meridian, very, very important. Again, Chinese. Now, you've all seen pictures in Japan, Korea, China, where they have their temples, and they always have a kind of a temple structure. You know, they have this thing up with a big lintel on it, you know, like that. They look so picturesque. The gate, you know that? Mm-hmm. This is time to go, mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Those are called min in Chinese. Very, very important. So this point here is called Ming Men. Ming, life, men, the gate of. This is the gate of life. And when the Chinese say something like that, ooh, it's very solemn. They really mean that. It wasn't just some little scribe, ooh, we'll call this over here, you know. No, this has a deep, deep meaning. If you look at the Chinese characters for this and start analyzing the characters and the radicals for this word, oh, you'll see a whole universe unfolding from you of life. This is down, this point, do my fear, which is Ming Men, the gate of life, is kind of like down between the second and third lumbar vertebrae on the yin channel of the body. And look at, there's the navel on the Rein Mai 8, right here. Just opposite, we have the gate of life. This is our energetic gate of life, the catabolic, that navel there, here, that was our nourishment in the embryo state, is the anabolic part that builds us up. But there we have the great Einsteinian transformation of matter and energy. We've got two navels. One of them is physical, where we see that go in because it's anabolic and because it's part of the way organisms express themselves physically, having to do with nourishment in yin, kapha, the organs and the cellular tissues. That's here. We can see, oh, there's my navel. Right. But you've got a navel back here, which is actually the gate of life, because that's the energy navel. And it's just as important. It's this part here, which is called Hansen's plet. Oh, in Danish, what do I say? Spot something. I can't think of the English word right now. In embryology, in the very first form of the embryo, that's what this is right there. Thank you. That's exactly it. Hansen's node. That is Ming Men. That's what develops in the full-born to the Ming Men. And that's how important that is. Now again, what I'm trying to impress upon you, where does all this start? Shirel controls all this because it's the Shao Yin, the kidney yin, which structures everything from hereditary forces, constitutional forces, through current digestive and physiological processes in the body. That's all in the kidney yin. And then the heart fire, this sacred fire of the heart, which is identity, which is the physical, emotional, spiritual matrix of each individual organism, controlled from this part here. This Chong Mai is extremely important in understanding this aspect of dentistry. Now, the Chong Mo meridian itself, this whole configuration here, is the foundation of all embryological development. You will find, if you go through the details in the development of the embryo, you will see that it's actually the Chong Mai meridian which is developing. It's the matrix upon which the embryo builds itself and manifests itself. That's how important that is. And it follows what in Sanskrit they call the Mahashrodas, which is the general intestinal tract. And our esteemed colleague from yesterday said, well, the seats of the doshas, the vata, pitta, and kapha, are here in these transforming areas in time and space of what builds our organism, incarnates it into time and space. So we have the kapha up here in the lungs and the stomach. We have the pitta here in the solar plexus chakras that have to do with the liver, gallbladder, small intestine, etc. And then we have the vata down here in these primary energy, transformation of energy and matter centers that we have in our body. So the vata, pitta, and kapha doshas are all in the Chong Mai meridian. And we see, I'm just bringing that in because some of you, you know, sort of are in one camp and then some in the other. And that's all right. We get along okay together. Now, I want to show you another one of the meridians here to show you how important this whole thing is. What have I got here? This is the internal meridian of the stomach. Now, when we're talking about stomach meridians or the stomach nadi, we're talking about stuff that's very, very important for dentistry. Look here again. There we have Qi Chong, that stomach 30 point that I talked about before. That's also on this meridian. Also very important to know that. The entire general intestinal tract, including the stomach, is on this meridian. The thyroid gland is controlled from here. Now, the thyroid gland is the most misunderstood glands, and everybody is on this poor gland. There are, and of course you know that that being a woman is a very dangerous occupation in the Western world, because all women have low thyroid, and their reproductive organs are all really bad, and their hormones are terribly screwed up, and they're basically walking disasters that have to be fixed quickly as possible. And everybody, including naturopathic doctors, they're all on these glands. Give them some thyroid, you know, and just stuff like this. And it's okay because it's natural thyroid. No, it's not okay because it's not the thyroid. It is not the thyroid. The thyroid is a symptom. Don't touch it. Leave it alone. You do anything to it, you're going to screw things up even worse than before. You know, and now that we have women voting, we don't want to do that. So, now, the reason being, it's because of this. This thyroid is being controlled by what? It's being controlled by things happening in the oral cavity. This is the stomach meridian. It's also the meridian that controls the thyroid. It's also connected directly to stomach 30 qi chung, where all of the metabolism of the body-mind matrix is taking place. The thyroid is a victim. So we've got to go to the source of what's going on. Just look at how this goes. You know, TMJ? When I talk TMJ, there it is. When I talk the alignment of the facial alignments, of the facial bones, of all the things here, look where this goes. All the roots of the teeth, the jaw bones, on both the facial bones, the temporal bones, all of this, including the thyroid, and the projections back into the cervicals, the clavicles, and the trapezius, and all of these other things. You can get all kinds of people to hold forth on this all day long about what these structures really mean. Look at the diaphragms here, and look at the intestinal muscles. Look at the joints that you've got going on in here, and the knee joints, and this and this. We saw this wonderful film by Dr. Klinghart and another gentleman, I'm sorry, I forgot the name of right now, but about this woman, you know, that had these problems walking and all this. That's it. That's why. That's why. And we need to know this. And to know what it means. And these aren't just lines of energy. Don't get this wrong. This is not like hooking things up electronically, like a robot. Whoa, I've got this, my channel, my little wire here is out, so you've got to repair that. That's not how this works. These are metabolic energies. These energies transform matter and create matter and transform from matter into life energy again. That's what's going on. We have to learn the alchemy of the body and the living organism in order to deal with these things correctly. We're not just repairmen or linemen out hooking up more wires. Now, and they go up to the eyes, by the way. I just wanted to point that out. Vision problems, eye problems, sinus problems, etc. All from this. And it isn't just the teeth, is it? These are feedback mechanisms. This is a whole loop going on constantly like this, all the time. The oral cavity, extremely important, but it's part of a loop. And we have to see it and appreciate it in that way. Now, another one I'd like to show you is the distinct meridian muscle of the stomach. Now, most of these are pretty, they're complex because they don't usually teach this stuff in acupuncture school. See, every meridian, main meridian, has five different separate meridians, and there's a whole bunch of extra ones. And I'm only going to these kind of things because that's the most interesting part. This really tells you what's going on. These main meridians, they don't really have much to say. But anyway, this is the distinct meridian of the stomach. Look at this, again. Look at everything going on, controlled there by, and the stomach meridian starts up here, because it's a yang meridian. And what's going on there? And how this goes down? Where does it go? Directly into the heart. Directly into the heart. And then directly into the major organ of the kapha system. This is the what in Sanskrit we call the rasa dhatu is controlled by this organ. Lymph, breast milk, all these very anabolic energies and parts of our physiology controlled by this. There's stomach 30 again, you know, connected right to the reunion of food and the sea of nourishment, going down the legs, into the feet, into the toes. So important that we see how this really fits in. And again, major points in the oral cavity. This next one here, which we can say a little bit about, is the tendo muscle meridian of the stomach. Again, the stomach. See where we are? In the TMJ, whole oral cavity. breasts. This, ladies and gentlemen, believe me, is the causal origin of all breast cancer. This is what makes it. Yes, the stomach meridian, breast cancer. I can assure you that when you take your anamnesis with a patient, with a breast cancer patient, you will find, if you diligently do your work on the etiologie of this patient, you will find problems in the oral cavity of one type or another, and you will find previous disturbances in the urogenital tract, because the breasts, like the thyroid, are totally innocent, absolutely innocent. It's because the breasts are the most sensitive of the kapha-producing, the basic psychosomatic organs of our body, which are very weak in that sense. They're so sensitive. They're not weak, excuse me. They're sensitive. So you're getting these short-circuit energies coming from the rear genital tract and the oral tract, and they collide right in the breast tissues. Now, if you want to cure breast cancer, stop trying to kill those damn cells. They've got nothing to do with it. Those are just under circumstances, they're perfectly normal. These cells just want to live. And you know what a cancer cell is doing? It's bailing out. It's not making a mistake. It's making the right decision. It's saying, this organism is going down the tubes. I want to become independent. I don't want to be controlled by mechanisms in this organism. I'm going to set up my own life and live with my buddies here, and we're going to be okay because we're going to start new life. That's what you call a neoplasm. See, it's not a pathology at all. It's life trying to stay alive. Why? Because we blew it. This whole organism here has done things to itself that will not support life. So what do you get the consequences? New life, which is a neoplasm, and death for the original organism. This is just nature's way. You know? So where do we go? Let's go to blast these cells. Those are the critters. No, they're not the critters. You're the critter. See? You're the thing threatening those poor cells. So you better stop it. You better find out how this stuff works. Why so important here? Remember what I said. Please remember, all basic immunity, all basic biologic energy comes from there, the reproductive organs. It reproduces our body, minds, and spirits to who we are, keeping us alive. That's why it's important. Where does that energy go? Right up into the breasts. Now, if something's goofing that up, and women are, I don't know, I guess maybe, I hate to call them victims, that sounds patronizing, but boy, they sure have had a hard time in our modern free age here. You know, IUDs and birth control pills and things you stick up and things you blow out and things you know, and it's like, and everybody seems to love that. Of course, it's only a man that could figure out to make those things, right? So you go ahead, take one of these or stick that up. This is really going to work. And you're going to be happy about this. And of course, what you end up with is a hell of a lot of breast cancer, right? And a hell of a lot of thyroid problems. And then we look at these women and say, well, they certainly are the weaker sex. It's true, you know. But why? Because look at what we're doing to these poor organisms. And we think it's okay because we're just machines. It's all right. It's like your car. You know, you can go in and get your cylinders bored out. It just makes you faster, you know. In a human organism, it makes you dead. You see? So we have to learn that. And again, this, please, my esteemed colleagues, do not forget this part. This is why you're doing the service to mankind in your medicine and dentistry, which is so very, very important. You are working in the most vital areas of this living organism. Remember back to Shirel here that we're talking about, right? In the whole oral cavity situation. That's very important. Now, this tendo muscle meridian controls all the Wei Qi and the Ojas, which is the immunity, all genetic and constitutional metabolic energies, all this stuff we're talking about with genes and DNA and all this kind of stuff, it's controlled from this meridian. This is what's doing it, and these connections. It makes what they call in Chinese zhong qi, which is Which are these metabolic energies, which I'm just mentioning that for those of you who are into this Chinese stuff. And it works off of these reproductive organs that I mentioned, and it has to do with the thyroid and the TMJ. Very important to see those connections. Now, I will just present one other meridian here. And this is rather important, even though it looks like this is a cute one because it's not much on it. It's the longitudinal low vessel of the colon. Now, again, forget all these terms. If you're really making your living as an acupuncturist, then you want to know what a longitudinal low vessel is. But if you're not, forget it. But it's a very important meridian. First of all, it has a lot to do with the oral cavity, with the structure, TMJ, and all that kind of stuff. Also, it goes down in here into the shoulder joint. Kind of interesting. This rotator cuff nonsense is a lot of it's there. It also goes down into here, which is a major DNA point, by the way. But the important part of this is what you can't see. This longitudinal low of the colon meridian is a reservoir for what they call yin qi. Now, yin qi is what they call in Sanskrit Dhatu Agni. And Dhatu means tissue in Sanskrit. Agni is this sacred metabolic fire of metabolism going on. All cellular, all tissue metabolism, which is called yin qi in Chinese, is controlled by this meridian. This meridian. And besides the wrist and the shoulder, that's where it's all coming from. Right up in the oral cavity there. Very important. This goes into the roots of all the teeth, just like the stomach meridian does. And you know what else it does? Just look at this. This is really funny. It goes up into the ear. Into the ear. Why the ear? Our colleague here in Ayurveda could tell you why the ear. Because, now, this is the little test. And you get a little gold star if you can answer this. The sense organ of the ear controls what element in the five elements?
Metal.
No. No.
Water.
No. We're getting close.
Earth.
No. Wood. Wood. Ether. Ether. Space. Because this energy of space has one of its locations in the function of the ear senses. Because the hearing is not obliged by things in time and space. We can hear around corners and we can't see around corners. Hearing is the sense organ, not just metaphorical, but also true enough. We have a tremendous amount of space in our ears. Of this element, this metaphoric element of space. And therefore, this meridian that controls all tissue and cellular metabolic events of the mind-body matrix has this wonderful emptiness, this void, the chung and the kung in it. It's the crucible of biological emptiness that doesn't restrict things, that allows these events to take place. That's why the ears are so very important and why the oral cavity does things to the ears and the other way around. Now, that's basically what I had to show you. But the point is in this, of course, maybe I shouldn't be saying that. I should have a lot of confidence you've already got the point. But I'll sort of stress it. The point in all this is that the oral cavity is of immense importance. And remember, it's a feedback loop. It's a feedback loop. These things are all connected. It's sort of like, remember in the old days with the Christmas trees, when you had the Christmas tree lights, and they're all in series, and a whole string would go out, and you have to find the one, you have to test all the bulbs and find out where, because they were all, that's how these meridians work. You start doing something to a vasectomy, for example, or a tubal ligation, or an IUD, or something. You start doing something to these pelvic areas, and where is that all going to end up? Because it's like a mirror. We have two energy polarities, which are functional in the same way, the oral cavity and the pelvic organs. That's where all nutrition, all the Einsteinian transformations of matter and energy take place. Oral cavity, reproductive organs. And conversely, where is all that problem from the mercury going to go? And the poorly done root canals, or the bite, or all these things that you people are much more competent to speak about than I am, where do you think all that ends up? There. And what happens when we got these problems? Everything in between gets short-circuited. Heart disease, breast cancer, ulcers, funny things with the blood, whatever, all these other extraneous pathologies, all you should all be looking at the foundation. Don't get blinded on the forest for the trees. You know, well, my electron microscope tells me it's this thing. No, 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 no. That's just doing what it would do under the circumstances. You have got to understand the foundation. Go back to the foundation. Why would this be happening? Ah, the yin qi is goofed up. Why? Look at your patient. Take the anamnesis. You'll find it. Very simple. You don't need all these big expensive machines. Just look at their history. What has been done to them? How has their organism acted? Well, when I was 5 years old, I had a lot of earaches. Interesting. Between 1973 and 1978, I had an IUD. Interesting. Et cetera, et cetera. You've got to understand what these means, all these things mean in terms of how living organisms function in their most basic sense. Once you do that, the rest of the stuff is going to fall right in, and you'll be able to work out a treatment strategy which actually promotes health. Now, that's the difference between classical medicine and allopathic medicine. And then I'll close for this, probably running over time. And that is, in classical medicine, we are promoting our therapy, diagnosis, is promoting health in the organism. The basic health of the organism will heal it. The allopathic way is to fight disease. All of our terms in allopathic medicine and even in dentistry, it sounds like some kind of a George W. Bush SWAT team. This is our war against evil. And we got this team of guys, you know, going in, and they've got the CDEs, and you've got the MUIs, and we're going to get in there and do this. And this power, you know, it's an analogy, but it's really true. We're going to get these bad guys. We're going to go in, and we're going to slaughter a bunch of cells, and we're going to and we're going to wipe out these diseases, and then, as though the organism were innocent. I'm just an innocent person. I'm completely perfect. I'm just walking down the street, and, oh, I got a virus. Oh, man, they're all over the place. They're coming, like, you know, and I got to use this soap that's on television, because if I use this soap that's got antibiotics, I spray it all over, the kids come in, play, hey, mommy, put the antibiotic soap on, and then you know it's okay. You just saved a life. My God, they could have had a bacteria. And they'd be dead, you know? How do these things happen? These are life forms. These are life forms. They're not enemies. They're only that way because of what we do to this person, which is a host for life, for all life. We have to learn how that works and take the time to look into a vision of how reality is in living organisms. And then we'll develop the strategies for the treatments and all this other stuff, which is very good. Please don't get me wrong. I'm not being condescending at all about any of these other areas. They're very important. But we need to get this part in too. Because if we don't, we're going to be remaining back in the Stone Age, and there's not an awful lot of difference between one of these really great new drills, which I hate because I'm scared of dentists, and a big hammer and a mallet. You know, it's the same kind of concept. Now it's okay. Well, no, not really. Let's look at it from how this beauty, and it's truly a beauty. This is an art. It's poetry. It's beauty. See how the beauty moves, and see how beauty creates biological processes. Then we'll start to appreciate this and understand how all these things are happening, including all our bacteriology and all these things. We'll understand it better, and we'll be able to respond in therapy better to what we need to do. Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy for your
On your large intestine radio there, you show it kicking back to the ear.
Mm-hmm.
That's non-classical. I mean, how
that calls almost to the
meridian so they can hear you. You have good questions. Nobody can hear you.
Okay, the question is, on a large intestine meridian, the classic meridian goes up the throat over here and across over this way. But you're showing a little wing going back here.
Right, that's because what you're talking about is the main meridian of the colon does that.
Yes.
But this is the longitudinal low meridian of that main meridian.
Okay.
There are five different meridians for every main meridian. And what Vaughn is talking about is the main meridian of the colon. And interestingly enough, thank you for bringing it up, Vaughn, that does come up over here, and it goes right into the ethmoid sinuses. All of the immune cells of the sinuses are controlled by this colon meridian. So where does that come from? Oh, interesting, huh? Right in there in the teeth. And yes, that's the main meridian of the colon, yes. Sir?
How do you combine modalities then? I mean, let me paint a rather poignant picture. A 32-year-old single mother of three comes in with breast cancer, metastatic to her axillary nodes. Would you advise against chemotherapy, against radiation, against lumpectomy? Would you advise acupuncture or oriental medicine only? Would you suggest that she undergo acupuncture and the treatments to help her meridians before she goes to therapy? In other words, how would you balance this?
I don't. I have a different way of, and again, I'm not being flippant. That's a very, very good question. I assume that people come to me because they want my services. And what I do then is I don't advise people what to do at all because it's their life, it's their disease, it's their healing. I'm there to support them. And what I do is describe to them, to best of my knowledge and best of my ability, what I think is the problem, what I think is the origin of the problem, and how I would go about solving it. Now, if that sounds comfortable to them, and they feel good about that, then we do it. If they don't, then I say there are other modalities of people doing other things, including chemotherapy and everything, and I say, and that does this and this and this. Because ultimately, it's kind of our, we call it karma in Sanskrit, and karma doesn't mean some kind of woo-woo, you know, on the stars, and not at all. It means action. It just means that there's going to be consequences for every action, consequences for not action. And I'm not the master of this person's life. They are. And therefore, I have to give them the knowledge and the options to make a qualified judgment about what they feel comfortable doing. Some of them say, well, I really want you to do this because I really believe in this, but I want to take chemotherapy. I say, okay, this is not my job to do it. My job is to educate, care, and do what I do. No, they're actually, interestingly enough, spread out on this because in energetically, this is really great. This is the yang part of our body here. This is where we are into what we call the earlier and later heavens in Chinese, and down here is the earth points. And all of our digits here, very interestingly enough, they're not just little things to keep us upright because we wouldn't have to have all this 20 toes. We could have a big plate here that a shoe would fit on, and it would work too. But we have these because these are extensions of energy points, and all the Jing Well points, these are points of energy confluences that come up and spring up from the earth and from the sky. They're all on the ends of our digits here, you see. Really beautiful. Look at the way the body is put together like this. It's a work of art. It's beautiful and it's inspiring. So we meditate about these things. Look at the body and meditate. It's really, really lovely. Okay.
Somebody that wants more information, right?
Okay.
Like especially a patient, for example, if you're trying to impart this information to them.
Thank you for that question. And I'm not trying to be ambiguous when I answer it. If we're brainy types, there are some books, very few, but there are some books that you might be able to get about this stuff, if that's the way one satisfies. When you're working with a patient, however, we have to remember one thing. We're doing this in this conference because we're all brainy. And we mostly feel comfortable that we're all brainy. We're all a little screwed up too because we're so brainy. But this is what makes us comfortable, is doing things like this. Now most patients we get, they're not brainy like that. And they'd feel uncomfortable sitting here with a bunch of brainy people. But remember, everything I'm telling you here, this is a picture of how all these organisms work, including this patient who is not brainy and doesn't have any idea about this. So in summary, summing that up, your greatest job In classical medicine, the teacher in Ayurveda, for example, is called a vaidya, which means wise man. Our job is to teach. Secondarily, it's to interfere with the body with a treatment. Primarily, it's to care for and educate. Because in Tibetan medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, ignorance is the source of all disease. Ignorance. So, our first job is to communicate with the patient. Now you have to know, and you have to believe, and you have to understand that even though we're a little neurotic and brainy because we went through the educational system, this patient isn't. This patient knows all this stuff because they've experienced it. So find the language that they speak about their own experiences. Well, I kind of felt like this and that. Oh yeah, we know it's like this and that. Isn't it true? And isn't that feel like? Bring them into their own, honoring their own experience of themselves as a living organism, as a living person and identity, because they'll understand every single thing you say about that if you show them this and say, oh yeah, that's like this, and that's why it's, you know, and you know, oh yeah, that's how it felt. Now I said that to this doctor before and he said, you know, take some Zoloft, you know, and it's, or that they don't want to hear it. You know, we have to validate it because, believe me, the patients are going to intuitively know what you're talking about if you can speak this metaphoric language of what's happening. And you're bringing them back into an area of responsibility for them where they're really part of it instead of we're doing the repair job here. You know, come back at 3 o'clock, your car's ready. You know, it's not like that. So that's about the best answer I can give you is...
Mm-hmm. Not certain whether it was the kidney or, and it was two cancers. And it's about healing. I can't remember the exact name. I'm sure a lot of people here have heard of Andrew Weil and know his book. But that's one of the things I use because it talks about cancer as being a part of you. You're not. It's not something that you're at odds with. It's something that he actually literally faced it and turned himself towards it as a part of himself and healed his cancer. Of that. He was a Japanese doctor. He was in Japan. So it may be that that would be helpful in explaining, you know, in a less brainy way to patients their relationship without blame to the organism that they're living in.
That's true, but we have to be a little careful with that. There's a little glitch that could happen in things like that, and that is that case histories, I don't know about how you people feel about it, but I always feel very intimidated by that because... I just know that all these people that I read about that are doing these things, I just know I'm not like that. I can't do that. I'm too screwed up. And I can never get that stuff together. And I'm not that disciplined. And I just, you know, and I read that stuff and I say, oh man, I'm going to have to do this. You know, I don't know. I don't think this is good. You know, and you kind of feel, you know, so what we have to do is find their language and we have to show them how they're doing it. See, you're already doing this. And this is how you're doing it. Wow, you know, this really, I'm really doing that. I'm not just a sick person. I'm a real person. And a real person is alive and doing this, you see. And once we get their attention about life and health, rather than saying, yeah, you really got this bad pathology, but we're going to do this great treatment on you, and you're going to be well. That right away puts them into something that, you know, they're going to be very grateful, and they should be, but... They're going to go away and say, gosh, this guy's really great. I'm such a loser that I had to even end up there, but he's great. If I ever start losing again, I'll go over there again. No, wrong attitude, right? Dear?
I think that most patients are very uncomfortable with patients that can't talk to themselves. And in trying to provide a little bit more of my sense, more square, mainstream, down to earth language than your beautiful description of energy. I think it's so important to remember that to gently move them into the position of any degree of position, any degree of empowerment, that it has a concrete physical, neurological function when they make a decision. And it doesn't necessarily have to do with whether they do chemo or whether they do radiation, whether they buy vitamin C or get injections with something or do chelation. It is the fact that you gently move them to a point of a decision. And that can be done without necessarily providing them with a feeling of guilt of having developed cancer.
Exactly. Thank you, Gita. That's very, very true. That's part of the caring. Remember, in the Semitic religions, the healer is the shepherd. It's the shepherd. The great archetypal concept of God is the shepherd. Yes?
Could you make comments about the prostate that may parallel the breast?
Thank you, sir. Same thing. When we're looking at organs now, we just didn't have time today to go into the organ systems connected with these energy things. But every one of these meridian channels that I showed you today all go through the prostate, all govern all genital, including prostate functions. It's all part of the same tissue system. And therefore, we're talking about the same thing, basically. And somebody mentioned this a while ago in previous talks here about connection of the prostate cancer and things like this to oral cavity things. Yes, indeed. Very true and very important. And by looking at these functional metaphors of the organism, we can really get how this works. And remember, these are, if I dare say it in a group like this, these are meditative areas. You see, this is not just information. It wouldn't hurt to sit down with that picture of that meridian in front of you or that yin-yang symbol and just sit there and look at that for a while and say, gee, now let me just play. Let's just play right now that in spite of what the dental schools and the medical schools have told me, this is really how it works. This is a universal model for the metabolism of all cells, tissues, mind and body matrix. What does that mean? You know, just give yourself 5 minutes at least, six, and look at that, and meditate about it, and then you'll see these things happening in the body. You'll begin to understand that. And when somebody comes in and says, well, I've got, and the first word out of the mouth, you'll say, ah, I know what that is. It's, you know, it'll go all there, and your treatment strategies will start working out and say, okay, we're going to do this. And remember, and Gita was into this too, just in another way, treatment strategies. The least you can do, every form of therapy, and I don't care, I don't like these things about natural, unnatural therapy, every form of therapy is artificial. Every form of therapy is phony to a living organism. Every form. There are just some forms of therapy that are more benign than others. That's the only difference. No therapies are natural. That does not exist. It's an oxymoron. Why? Because true health and true life have to do with natural states of being. And we are so unbelievably neurotic in a country like America that we're constantly on therapy. When we finally get our cavitations taken care of, we finally get our thyroid done, we finally get our teeth shrunk or whatever we're doing or our toes fixed or, you know, all these things, then we go on some kind of prophylactic treatment. Well, I got to take all these vitamins and minerals because if I don't, you know, I'm dead, you know. So we're in constant therapy, and we're constantly looking for somebody. Well, I heard somebody, he's really good at this. I better go see this guy. We're in a constant state of therapy, which means we don't have a life at all, because we have to, as therapists, we have to do the least possible work we possibly can, and the most gentle and the slowest, because the great power of healing, the great origin of life itself in that patient is in the patient. And your therapy, no matter what it is insignificant in that sense. And remember the homeopathic idea, Abram's law. The least stimuli is going to produce the greatest effect in a biological organism. Gentle. Yes? No. except for, not really. You see, in terms of God, the immanence of the divine is in the Agni. We might say the Ayurveda have that very wonderfully. The other part about the evil is usually in the Oriental schools of thought is considered to be ignorance. Now, even in the Semitic religions, if you go back to the concept of Satan or Satan, We have to remember in Latin he's called Luciferus in Latin, Satan, the devil. The light bringer, Luciferus, the light bringer. Now how did that get in? Yes, Lucifer. Now how did that get in there? Well, because you remember in Christianity, in Latin, they say God is the light of lights. Huh? Light of lights, whereas Satan is just the light, which means that when we just have a flashlight and we're looking around and we see things just like we do in regular academic medicine, ah, there's a cell, oh, there's a DNA thing, oh, there's that thing. We don't see with the light, with this wholeness. So we wander around in ignorance, but we're brilliant at it. I got this big, powerful beam flashlight that's, you know, I can see out, you know, right in this thing. Everything else is dark. It doesn't look that way to me. And then I tell everybody about it. You know what's out there? And then I get this new theory, and I say, I really discovered it. This is wonderful. You know, now we got it. Now we try it out for a few years, find out we really don't have it, but it's coming. We're getting it. It's going to come, right? You see? This is the devil. This is true evil, you know, doing that. Yeah, I'm going to have to leave, but that's...
We all leave and we go... There's a hush, and everybody goes, what is that?
Oh, no, don't tell me that.
I'm not being critical.
Oh, okay.
I make a small thing. I mean, this is deep thought. I mean, this is incredible.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
That makes sense, no, but I got to digest this. It's not something... It's not like listening to somebody else or myself or I give an x-ray or something. This is a deep thought process that you convey to this. Mm. This is not something you pick up and say, oh, I get it right away. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes you so unique in the way you speak. Mm.
Well, I would recommend one thing, and this is not, please believe me, I don't get any percentage on this, but I would say probably buy the video because, as Chris says, this is pretty difficult stuff. I'm trying very hard not to make it difficult, but I think it would help, especially if those little things got on there. I didn't do that last time, and I even got confused myself. So, but this is, yes, and thank you very much.
Save your questions for the panel at the end of the show, okay? Let's take a break, about a half-hour break in the back. I have a short speech, and then we'll finish up, okay? Thank you. Thank you. Good job, thanks.
That was absolutely fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
It's